Hello, I'm going to talk today about ground testing for high power rocketry. I'm getting ready to ground test this rocket. This is a rocket built from a kit called the Lotus 5 by Composite Warehouse. It's a 5-inch all fiberglass rocket that uses head-end ejection. This is a little unusual. Most rockets, most high power rockets that use dual deployment have a second airframe section up here that would contain the parachute. On this rocket, there will be a set of charges below the coupler here that will separate the rocket here at apogee. And then there will be a second set of charges on top of the coupler that will pop the nose cone off when you want the main to come out. And the main parachute will be up here. Ground testing is very important for high power rocketry, for any rocket that you're going to set up for dual deployment. Generally because you're going to be using shear pins. Shear pins are just little nylon screws that will fit into holes that you've drilled where you want your main deployment separation point to be so that it doesn't come open when your apogee deployment goes off. But because of that, you want to make sure that your, especially that your main deployment charge is strong enough to separate the rocket and shear all the shear pins and get the main parachute out. The first thing that you're going to want to do when you're getting ready to plan your deployment and then go to ground test it is to figure out what your starting size is going to be that you're going to try for your deployment charges. The deployment charges are little capsules of black powder that will be detonated by an electric match. But there are calculators online, I'll put a link to one of them here, that you can use to put in the dimensions of your rocket, and then it'll give you back an estimate of how much black powder you should use for that deployment charge. Most of these calculators are set up to assume that you're talking about a cylindrical airframe section, because here we're using head-end ejection. This section is not cylindrical, it's a cone. So you need to dig back to your high school geometry and remember that the volume of a cone is 1/3 the volume of a cylinder of the same dimensions. So when I put this into the calculator, I just cut the height in half, or in a third, divide by 3 to come up with the equivalent volume that's needed for the ejection charge up here. What that told me was that I needed an ejection charge of a little bit less than a gram of black powder up here. It was about 0.85 grams, and then about 2/3 of a gram down here. So that's what I'm going to start with. I'm going to show you how I do my ejection charges. This is not the only way to do it, but this is a method that's convenient for me and has worked well for me in the past. These little plastic tubes are centrifuge tubes. You can buy these from Amazon or a scientific supply store, maybe if you have access to such a thing, but Amazon carries them. This is a 1.5 cc centrifuge tube. I have some bigger ones that I use for bigger rockets, but this is going to be big enough for this rocket here. What I do is I drill a hole down in the lower end of the centrifuge tube. I pass an electric match through it, and then I seal it with a little dot of epoxy, so that it makes it very durable, won't come apart. Then when it's ready to ignite, you'll wire it up to your altimeter contacts, however you're doing that. The altimeter will push a little bit of electric current there to set off the match, which will burn the powder and eject whatever you're trying to eject. These are graduated in cubic centimeters, so rather than weigh my powder, I'm going to use the density of black powder, which is a little bit more than a gram per cc. It's for loose powder, it's about a gram and a half. So for my charge, my main charge, I'm going to start with about 2/3 of a cc, which should be about a gram of powder. Okay, I've got the first one of these made up. This is about a 1 gram charge of black powder. I wanted to go ahead and show this before I put tape on it and kind of hide what's going on here. This is a tube just like this. It's got the match head down at the bottom. Filled up with about a gram of black powder, and then I put just regular recovery wadding, like you would use for an Estes rocket, to fill up the rest of the space in the tube. So, you know, in flight, if you're going to use this for an actual flight, you don't want the powder to slosh around in there and fall away from the match head, because then it might not ignite properly. For this rocket, I'll show you in a second how I've got my electrical connections set up, but I put two little ring terminals on here, so these will just bolt onto my terminals for my rocket. If you were going to transport one a charge like this, you would want to shunt these together just to make sure it doesn't build up static electricity and run a risk of setting it off prematurely, since I'm going to take this and put it straight in the rocket, which is right behind me. I'm not going to do that. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take electrical tape. I usually just put a loop of tape over the top of the canister and then another loop around the circumference just to hold it together and make sure it doesn't come open. Okay, I just wanted to take a minute and show what the inside of the electronics bay looks like, because I do like to think about ground testing when I'm laying out the electronics bay, and build in connectors for that if I need it to do my ground testing. In this case, I've got a plug wired to my terminals down here on the Apogee side for ground testing, just wired in alongside my regular connections from the altimeter. Up here, because I had to have a plug anyway, to plug the bulkhead together so I can take it apart and put it back together, I'm just using the same connectors for my test plug that gets wired up here to this set of terminals for ground testing. So I'll have an extra plug like this that I'll just plug in either in place of the altimeter plug if I'm testing the main side, or plug into here if I'm testing the Apogee side. It just has two ring terminals that'll run out through the hole in the coupler. Okay, I've got this sort of fake put together here. This is not nearly as good as I will have it when I'm ready to fly it, but I'm not going to fly it for a few more months, so I've got some time to think about how I want to do this. In fact, now that I've got this assembled and I'm looking at it, I think I want a longer shock cord. Probably don't need this thick a shock cord, so I'll probably replace this with something that's longer and thinner, because I think I've only got about 15 or 20 feet of shock cord in here, and I would like it to be longer just to let the pieces get further apart and give the parachute more room to eject. But anyway, I do have the parachute that I'm intending to use in here with the chute protector. It's a Fruity Chutes 48-inch parachute. It's the pilot chute that I used for my Level 3 rocket, but it's just about the right size for this rocket. It's important to do your ground testing with the rocket in the configuration that you're going to fly, because it can affect how things work. If I just ejected this with no parachute, no shock cord, no anything in it, it wouldn't necessarily tell me how it's going to work when I go to fly it. So this is approximately how it's going to be when I go to fly it. I've got my ejection charge here. I'm just going to work this all together. This masking tape is to show me which side of the nose cone lines up with the camera. Just did that so that because it really only fits one way. The switch band is not completely straight, so I had to sand the nose cone a little bit to make it fit. I'm going to put shear pins in it now. The shear pins I'm using are just nylon screws. They're a number 2. You probably can't see that at all, but it's a number 2 nylon screw. It's, what is it, 3/8 of an inch long, I think. I just drilled this yesterday for the shear pins, hoping they will fit. Okay, the shear pins are in. Just going to take a close-up of this so you can see. Ended up just pushing them straight in with the flat part of a pair of lineman's pliers here, just like that. If you bend one, trying to get it in the hole, which is not uncommon, at least for me, pull it out and use a new one. You don't want to take a chance on getting it in there crooked where it's not going to shear cleanly. It's not worth, you know, a nylon screw that costs a fraction of a cent. And just in case it wasn't clear, when we say these are shear pins, it's because they shear off. As the nose cone ejects from here, those screws are just going to break right where they pass between the two pieces of fiberglass and shoot right off of there. That's the idea anyway. Okay, I'm finally ready to ground test. I have my rocket propped up here in my backyard. It's hooked up just to a regular model rocket launch controller I'm going to use to set off the match. I have my cameras rolling. A good continuity. So here goes my ground test. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Begin. Just going to come look at the aftermath here. Everything separated the way it was supposed to. When the shock cord, when the nose cone hit the end of the shock cord, it pulled the coupler out of the body of the rocket. That almost always happens, and that's perfectly fine. It's dragged everything all out, all the way to the end of the shock cord, which is good. This bundle here is my chute protector and my parachute. Got pulled out, that's good. If this were in flight, it would be unfurling right now. So that's what a successful ground test looks like. Thanks for watching.